Ted Williams said the hardest thing to do in a sport is hit a baseball.
I think he was right.
These guys make it look easy, but hitting a major league fastball pushes the brain and body to their very limits. I mean, how do these guys do it? Are they superhuman genetic freaks? Do they see the world in Matrix-like bullet time?
Now back, number 42, Joe the Hustle Hanson.
One of the first things they teach you in Little League is to keep your eye on the ball, but that's easier said than done. I can barely see that thing. A pitcher starts 60 feet 6 inches from home plate, but actually releases the ball several feet closer. At that distance, a 90 mile an hour fastball is only in the air for maybe 400 milliseconds. That's not a lot of time. And we can perform simple reaction tasks in less than 400 milliseconds, but hitting a baseball is a little more complicated. Hitters aren't just reacting to the pitch. They have to make a big stick arrive at the same time and location as a tiny moving sphere. They only have a 9 millisecond window to make contact, less than half an inch margin of error. To make things worse, the hitter's at a huge disadvantage. They're living in the past. We all are. Because of the time it takes our sensory information to be synchronized and processed, our consciousness lags 80 to 100 milliseconds behind actual events. By the time the brain registers there's a pitch on the way, it's already a quarter of the way to the plate. Considering the average major league swing takes about 160 milliseconds, that only leaves 140 milliseconds for the brain to think, swing, send a signal to the motor cortex, down to the arm, it takes longer than that to blink. Baseball great Yogi Berra allegedly once said, you can't think and hit at the same time. He was right, there's just not enough time to sense, decide, and act on a pitch. Baseball players almost have to think without thinking. The first phase begins before the pitcher even starts to move. How many outs are there? Where are the runners? What is this pitcher like to throw when there's two strikes? The context of the game can help narrow down the possibilities and give the hitter a sort of ballpark estimate. The pitcher winds up, the batter begins to move, and then things go subconscious. Batters go into every pitch as if they're going to swing. Their bodies have to get a head start. Their eyes are locked on the exact distance and location of the pitcher's release point. There's no time to focus or move their eyes into position. To hit the strike zone with any pitch, a pitcher has to release the ball within a cone just 2 degrees wide and within half a millisecond of their target. Batters are able to analyze tiny differences in the angle of release of the ball to determine if it has any chance of crossing the plate. From this point on, the batter just has to figure out when the ball will cross the plate and at what height. Easy, right? With data like velocity, rotation, parabolic motion, a computer could easily calculate the time of intercept. Unfortunately, we're not robots, and we've got to use sensory clues instead. When something moves closer to us, its angular size increases. The faster that shadow grows on our retina, the faster it's moving towards us. Because we have two eyes, each gets a slightly different view of that ball's growing shadow, and our brains are able to put together those tiny differences and translate it into the ball's flight path. The batter's eyes and head remain locked on that pitch until it's about 6 feet away from the plate, constantly adjusting their predictions along the way. If everything goes just right, what's crazy is nearly all of this bypasses a batter's conscious brain. How do they see all of this when my brain only sees a blur? The center of our retina contains the highest density of photoreceptors of anywhere in the eye. This is why we see best when we look right at something. But thanks to genetics, some people have more cells in the middle of their retina than others. A higher density of cones in a given area means more resolution. In eye exams, the average major league player tests at 20/13 vision, and 80% are below 20/15. Some even approach 20/8, the theoretical limit of human vision. In the 1990s, Los Angeles Dodgers scouts were able to predict which minor league players would succeed in the majors based solely on how they performed on eye exams. A baseball's red laces can give different pitches a telltale signature in flight. A two-seam fastball can look like two red stripes based on its backwards rotation. A slider's lateral movement can paint a red dot on one side. Hitters, thanks to their experience and their expert vision, are able to pick up on these patterns in flight. What distinguishes an expert hitter from, well, someone like me, is their ability to process information earlier, faster, and more efficiently. They've got some physical attributes that make them well-suited to cranking the long ball to the cheap seats, but they've also trained their brains to be specialized fast-motion processing devices. It's just as much about software as hardware, maybe even more. I clearly need an upgrade. Stay curious. This episode was sponsored by Dropbox. Whether you're designing, presenting, writing, or building, Dropbox makes it simple to work together on any file. Because if you can work with anyone, anywhere, any way you want, the world will be full of more interesting things. Dropbox, all yours. What color is the moon? I asked you all this question, and I got some very interesting answers. Silver, like aluminum. White, like the color of clouds. Chalky, like ash. Silver, kind of like an old coin. Or gray, like pavement. Silver, like your mother's hair. Milky, chalk. Gray, like a used eraser. White, like a diamond. But among all these varied responses and interesting comparisons, y'all pretty much agreed the moon is a very light color, something like this. But what if I told you it was actually more like this?